not standing on my soapbox up here. I'm a lone wolf. We do not have a woody ornamental pathologist. We do not have a woody ornamental weed scientist. So I have to beg people to try to help me develop this. And there just aren't the people to do it. So, and when you do find people and they're at another institution, yeah, they talk the talk. Yeah, I'm willing to help you, but then when the rubber hits the road. So the other thing is, once you print this, within days, it's out of date. So what I'm hoping to do with this is make an electronic. But I am, I'll divulge my age, I don't care. I'm 52. So I'm called what I sell the tweener. I'm kind of old school and I'm kind of new school because I use technology to its advantages. But I love hard copies of stuff. I'm sorry, this electronic, people send me manuscripts to review, to edit. And I'm like, I print it off. I chop down a lot of trees. But I can't handle doing stuff online. It just doesn't work for me. And I know that about myself. So it's one of my many, many endless weaknesses. Okay? So thank you, Sharon. I know she left already to go do some work. Oh, you're back there. She's got some work to do because I'm here to hopefully educate you. So my apologies. This thing's 2000 and no glasses. 11? So it's dated, but I've got it in the works. But Rome wasn't built in a day, and I'm a one-man band or a one-man wrecking machine. I'm not sure. So I have a lot of slides today, and it's not Sharon's fault that you don't have my handout because the file is so huge, I can't even Dropbox it. So I'm going to give it to her tonight. She's going to take her flash drive, thumb drive, pop it in there, and she'll have it. And then she can feebly attempt to upload it. I don't know if it's going to work or not, but we'll see. So to that end, there's lots of resources. This is a really good one. Of course it is because I'm an author, but aside from me being an author, this is probably the holy grail for me. And in here is too much information, way too much, but it's called Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs. And this is by Warren T. Johnson and Howard H. Lyon. There's a companion to this that has diseases in it. So is Brian, Dr. Huddleston been here yet?
No.
No. So he would tell you that's kind of a holy grail for him too. So in here, lots of information, too much information. But I don't know what this sells for. I'd hate to even guess what the price is anymore. I've had this since, I don't know, I've been at this a long time. Here, oh, 1990. So what? How many years is that? Too many. So anyway, the other thing I want you to understand very, very clearly, just because I am a professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison doesn't mean I know everything. So oftentimes I learn a lot from you folks. So I'm going to cover a lot of organisms tonight, and we're going to talk about the biology of them. And this is the most important thing I can tell you the entire presentation. When you buy a house, my mother sold real estate. What's the most important thing when you buy a house? Location, location, location. So the most important thing for these pests, we're going to be talking about insects. Brian's coming in, he'll talk about diseases. If we're talking about weeds, even if we're talking about plants, biology, biology, biology. So the biological knowledge is imperative. So there's a cliche out there, and I like it. Keep your friends close and your enemies close. So the more you know about the pest you're trying to feebly attempt to manage, I say that because sometimes it's tough. So very important to know biological knowledge. The more you know, the greater the likelihood of success. Does that make sense? Okay, good. I'm going to turn the lights down. And I don't like the fact that I don't have a lapel. I'll give you a backup. Here we go. How's that? Let's see.
That's good.
That's pretty good?
Yeah.
Most of you are going to go to sleep anyway, so it doesn't matter. Okay. And the other thing is, I told you I'm very informal. My name's Chris. It's not Dr. Williamson, but I'm told I have to do this, so, and put that up there. But I'm Chris. If you have a question, raise your hand. I will feebly attempt to answer. I don't have all the answers. Anybody that thinks they have all the answers usually doesn't know anything they're talking about. Isn't that right? Good deal. So we're all on the same page. So here's kind of an overview or an outline of what I'm going to be talking about today from an ornamental insect perspective. I'm going to be talking about a certain group called the sucking insects. I'll talk about Japanese beetle. I'll talk about another group of insects, which are the boring insects, no pun intended. And then I'll talk about gypsy moth, fall webworm, and then another one that we're really, it's starting to rear its ugly little head as the viburnum leaf beetle. You may have heard about that. So I'm going to try to go through these. Now, I want to preface this once again. I'm not an expert in all of these, but many of these I've spent a lot of time working on. Japanese beetle, I'd say I'm pretty darn good there. Bronze birch borer, pretty solid. Emerald bash borer, pretty solid. Linden borer, very solid. Gypsy moth, very solid. Viburnum leaf beetle, I'm going to talk about biology, but I'm not an expert on that. Sucking insects, I know them well, but I've got colleagues that they focus on working on those. So I've kind of likened myself. I have some specialization, but as my grandmother said, it's better to be a jack of all trades than a master of one. So here I am. All right, let's get right into it. Sucking arthropod pests. First of all, please raise your hand. I'm kind of curious. Has anybody in this group ever had some form or fashion of an entomology course? Yes or no? So not many. So, well, geez, does this thing disconnect? Because if it doesn't, Okay, so insects are divided into three morphological body regions. We have a head, a thorax, and an abdomen. Okay, so insects have three morphological body regions. Now, we have other arthropods that are called spiders, ticks, and mites. They only have two body regions. The head and the thorax is fused together to form one body region. We call the cephalothorax. And then it also has an abdomen. Another very discernible characteristic from an insect compared to a spider, tick, or mite. Insects, if they have legs, because here's a catch, not all insects have legs, but if they have legs, how many pairs of legs do insects have? Three, for a total of six. So three, and insects, if we compare insects to humans, there's no really need other than we can look at their nervous systems. There are some commonalities, but we have a closed circulatory system. Insects have an open one. Very important to know that too. Insects are cold-blooded animals. Humans are warm-blooded animals. So there's a lot of big differences. But if an insect has legs, which most do, they will have three pairs of jointed legs that are attached to what body region? Can anybody tell me?
Thorax.
Very good. And predominantly where, so if we have the top side of the animal and we have the bottom side of the animal. So you're standing, or you're sitting, and I'm standing before you. I'm facing you. What side of this body is this called that you're looking at? Or my chest, my tummy? Underside, but what do we call that? The ventral side. Very good. So if I were to turn around and you saw my derriere, what side would that be called?
Dorsal.
So a good way to remember that is dolphin, dorsal fin, top side. Okay? So on the top side of the animal, we call that the dorsal side. On the underside, the belly of the beast, if you will. We call that the ventral. So on the thorax, on the ventral side, if the insect has legs, that's where they're attached. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Good deal. So that was a crash course in entomology 101. Everybody got an A. So okay. So now we're going to talk about sucking arthropod pests. And when I say arthropod pests, very important, because we also have mites in there. So that's why I say arthropod pests. So many plants, pests with sucking moth parts belong to the order Hemiptera, which are the true bugs. This group includes aphids, cicadas, stink bugs, scale insects, and their kin. There are approximately 80,000 species that are known. No, I don't know all 80,000. I know a couple. Other plants with sucking moth parts include thrips, whiteflies, mealybugs, and certain mites. That's why when I put the title up there, sucking arthropod pests, because if I would have told you sucking insect pests and I mentioned mites, I would have been misleading you. Okay? So, and the other thing I wanted, before we get into this, so you guys have a little, understand me a little bit and have a little knowledge about me, because I keep seeing this guy sitting over here, and I won't point him out, but he's wearing a Michigan shirt. I'm an Ohio State grad, so I was going to ask him if he could put a jacket on to cover that up. But, and I happen to play football at Ohio State, so. But that being said, I'm from Ohio native, and I live in Stoughton. So I'm old farm boy is what I am. And I just went to school too long and happened to get a PhD. So a little bit about my background. Anyway, been at the UW 19 years. So anyways, when we talk about these other pests, there's several of them that are sucking, but remember there's mites as well. So I want to kind of give you a list here of ornamental, sucking pests of ornamental plants. So plant bugs, lace bugs, adelgids, aphids, leaf hoppers, tree hoppers, spittle bugs, jumping plant lice, those are psyllids, and then scale insects. We're going to really dive into those tonight because it's very important to understand biology, and I'll get into that in more depth. We'll talk about the two types there are. There's armored and soft, white flies, mealybugs, and thrips. We don't have time to go over all of these tonight. This whole lecture would be just based on sucking insects. But what we're going to try to do is tackle a few of them. So there are some distinguishing identifying characteristics that we look for. One of them is a distinct triangular region present on the wings. Now, I didn't mention this in my Entomology 101 a little bit ago. So I told you insects are divided into three morphological body regions. The head, the thorax, and the abdomen. If it has legs, the legs are attached on the ventral side on the thorax. Insects, not all insects have wings, but if they do have wings, where are they attached? What part of the body? Dorsal side, but what body region? Thorax. Very good. Very good. And entomologists call the thoracic region of an insect the locomotive. That's where most of the musculature is located. Okay? So not all insects have wings, but if you find an insect with fully developed true wings, they will only be in the adult stage. You will not find it in an immature life stage. But we're going to get tricked a little bit as we go. So on the dorsal side, on the wings, we see a triangular body region. And this occurs where the wings are folded over the body. And it's very, very discernible and distinct to the family Myridae, which are plant bugs. So if I highlight that, this is when I talk about that triangular region that you see there. Okay? So we're going to delve right into talking about one particular insect pest that's very problematic here in Wisconsin, which is the four-line plant bug. And I want you to be fully aware that there are different kinds of entomologists. I am an integrated pest management specialist. I focus on killing insects, controlling them to the best of our, manage them. So we manage them through a myriad of different approaches. So IPM, does everybody know what IPM is in here? I hope you do. Integrated pest management. So that includes biological, cultural, chemical, including insecticides in my particular instance, and also plant resistance. Those are the cornerstones of IPM. So when we start talking about these organisms, I'll talk about some of the ways in which we manage them. Unfortunately, many times and more times than not, it's chemical control is one of our predominant means of control. Now, I'll give you instances where we can implement biological control. I'll give you instances where sometimes cultural control works really well. But the point I want to make is there's different kinds of entomologists. We have entomologists we call taxonomists. They describe insects and categorize them. But when they name an insect, they don't always use great logic. And they'll call an organism, whatever they want to call it, for the common name, but then there's a scientific name. So it's important to learn scientific names, but let me give you an example of where I'm going with this. Let's take the eastern tent caterpillar. Anybody familiar with that? We're not going to have much time to talk about that today. We're going to talk about one of its closely related organisms called the fall webworm. Eastern tent caterpillar occurs in the spring. Fall webworm occurs in the... Oh, wow, they got that right. But eastern tent caterpillar, it occurs in the spring, and it builds nests, and it builds in the crotches of trees, where the fall webworm builds nests, but it builds it out in the extremities of the tree. But the point I'm trying to illustrate is, I wish they would have called eastern tent caterpillar spring tent caterpillar, because it occurs in the spring, but Nonetheless, you'll see there's some things that can be a bit confusing. So, in terms of the four-line plant bug, it's a pest on numerous annual and perennial plant material. Examples include azaleas, dogwoods, maples, sumac. Important to understand it overwinters as eggs. And I failed to do it again, Entomology 101. We categorize insects into two fundamental groups. We have insects that have complete metamorphosis. We have insects that have incomplete metamorphosis. You are looking at an organism, the four-line plant bug, that is an example of an insect that has incomplete metamorphosis. What do I mean by that? Some people call it simple metamorphosis. So you have adults, and remember, only adults have wings. You have both males and females. Once the female becomes mated, she lays eggs. Those eggs go through an incubation or gestation period. They hatch, and you get babies. Those babies closely resemble mama or papa. The difference is they don't have fully developed wings. And they grow and develop through a process that's regulated by insect hormones. We call that molting. So they'll grow from one life stage to the next. What's another big thing that's the difference between an insect and a human? We're warm-blooded, they're cold-blooded. What's another really big difference? We are vertebrates and they are invertebrates. So that's why they have to grow and develop to cast off their skin. I guess maybe an analogy you could think of is a snake. Snake, it sheds its skin. So that's one way maybe to think of it. So when we talk about the immature life stage of insects that have an incomplete life cycle, we call those nymphs. But what's really confusing, and I hate to bring this into it, but it gets really, some people call them larvae. I don't really agree or understand. I'm more confused than ever. But for today's purposes, we will call the immature life stage of insects that have an incomplete life cycle, we call them nymphs. And look here. Look at the dimorphism here that we see. So nymphs are red and black. They emerge and feed in April and May. And the adults, they're black and yellow. So there's a lot of color differences between the adults and the nymphs. And that's pretty uncharacteristic, because many times the nymphs of other species will very closely resemble the adults. But this is one unique situation where they're different. Another thing that's very important to understand with the four-line plant bug is there's one generation per year. Now, does anybody want to take a crack at why they named this the four-line plant bug? Because there's six lines, right? No, because there's four lines. Down, the dorsal side of the wing covers. Okay? Both the nymphs and the adults feed and cause damage. Well, the reason they do is because the nymphs have the identical types of mouth parts as what do the adults. Now, remember, four-line plant bug is an insect with incomplete metamorphosis. We're going to talk about some insects later that have complete metamorphosis. So the adults' mouth parts are nothing like what the larvae are. And we'll talk about that later. In terms of the damage that the four-line plant bug causes, it causes these dark spots on the leaves. They oftentimes stump the chump. I mean, resemble disease. So you send a sample in, and it goes to Brian, Dr. Huddleston, and he's like, he's really good at being able to diagnose. And then when he has a question where he's not 100% certain, he'll go up and talk to PJ. PJ Leash is our insect diagnostician. Anybody know who PJ is? Have you heard his name? Mm-hmm. PJ's outstanding. The reason he's so good is because he was my former graduate student. I'm kidding, he really was. Has nothing to do with me, trust me. But PJ replaced Phil Pelletieri, if you can do such a thing. So Phil retired about 4 years ago. And now PJ's in that role. But those two work as a team. So when they can't figure something out, they work really well. The other thing, when this damage occurs, it also causes curling of the plant tissues. Well, what other things cause curling of plant tissues? What are there some other abiotic things? How about frost? If a plant leaves out, you get frost damage. Herbicides can cause leaves to curl. So You see how this is very important when you start going into the diagnostics of trying to figure out. So you have to become Sherlock Holmes. What's going on here? And I am the chump up here. I've been stumped many a times by certain organisms. The other thing is, these plant bugs may drop to the ground and hide if disturbed. That's one of the characteristics that they can do. Another one, and we'll talk about control of these in a bit. Another one's an ash plant bug. Not that we have many ash trees left because of emerald ash borer, but we'll talk about ash borer today too. So they're pests of ash trees, and I say, there I say it, what is left? They overwinter as eggs. The nymphs, they're reddish. They emerge around leaf break. And the adults, they're about a quarter of an inch in length. They're black and yellow. Once again, you see that dimorphism, that color variation. And they can be found May throughout the growing season. And with this organism, contrasting and comparing to what we just talked about with the four-line plant bug, there's only one generation per year with this, and there's two with this one. Both the nymphs and the adults, they feed and cause damage to the plants. And what we find typically and historically is that that first generation in the spring is the most damaging because they're feeding on those young, succulent leaves. And in terms of how the type of damage that they cause, the yellowing, mottled appearances on the leaf surfaces, and then the younger leaves can appear wilted. So once again, you get into the diagnostics of this aspect. And then yet another hemipteran that we contend with is the honey locust plant bug. Anybody want to guess what species this predominantly attacks? Oaks, right? No, honey locust. So it's a pest of honey locust. Overwinters as eggs. The nymphs, and this is a good depiction here to show you the difference between a honey locust plant bug adult on the right and a honey locust plant bug nymph. I'm going to walk over here for a second so I can see better. So you see these rudimentary developmental wings, but they're not fully developed wings. You can discernibly see these fully developed wings. But they both have the same type of mouth parts, and they're going to cause the same type of damage. The adults are greenish as well. So here, yellowish greenish to greenish. So you really can't differentiate too much. One generation per year with these guys, and the populations, based historically, really start to decline in late June and into July. In terms of the damage symptomologies, they cause this mottling, distortion of leaves. Young leaves may be curled and resemble herbicide damage. So once again, we got to be very mindful. So when you send a sample in, say, hey, I've got this honey locust, and here's the damage that I saw. What do you think is going on? Very imperative to convey that information to the diagnostician when you send it in. What we do know, they do have a preference for varieties of yellow varieties of honey locusts, particularly sunburst, over some of the green varieties such as Shade Master or Skyline. So this really lends itself to showing there are varietal differences. So therefore, this is a good example of implementing host plant resistance. So we've got some species or some varieties, same species, but some varieties that are less likely to be damaged compared to some that are more favorable. So these are some of the things we can do. One of the problems is, if you didn't plant that plant material, it's really hard to discern or figure out what variety that you may have. But I would say to you, if they're getting damaged year in and year out, you probably have one of the yellow varieties. Lace bugs. Here in the Midwest, upper Midwest, several different species. There's just a myriad of different hosts, including azaleas, oaks, elms, birch, crabapple, lindens, aspens, willows, roses, many others. White or black colored, the wings are patterned with ornate, hence the name, lace bugs, lace-like pattern. So you look at that. They're actually pretty cool looking animals, but they have piercing, sucking mouth parts. All of these organisms that we've just talked about have piercing, sucking mouth parts. And I guess we got to go back to entomology 101. Some insects have chewing mouth parts. Some insects have piercing, sucking mouth parts. And what they do is they stick their proboscis in, it's like a hypodermic needle, and they suck plant juices out. And that's why we see that type of damage. These guys typically overwinter as adults, sometimes as eggs, but mainly as adults. And there's multiple generations per year. Here you can see down here is an adult, and then here's an immature. And you in the back, you're never going to see that, so I apologize. When they feed, they cause yellowing, and here's a generic term that you've heard before, chlorosis. How many things cause chlorosis? There's diseases that cause chlorosis. There are insects that cause chlorosis. There are mites that cause chlorosis. There are nutrient deficiencies that cause chlorosis. The other thing is there's a term that I present here called stippling. Does anybody know what that is? So when you have a leaf surface and you got these, like, I'll call them almost like pimples. They're raised. That's where an organism, in this case, lace bugs, fed upon the leaf. And then the plant physiologically responds to that feeding damage. And you get that little raised surface. We call that stippling. And mites do this as well. So we got to be really careful when we're attempting to diagnose. The other thing that's very important with this organism that we do know something about its biology, the lace bugs are predominantly found on the undersides of the leaves. So if you're looking on top and you're not seeing anything, but yet you see this chlorotic condition of the plant, you got to look a little closer to figure out what's going on. Okay, leafhoppers. A wide variety of plants are attacked by leafhoppers. And there's a lot of different species of leafhoppers. And when they do feed on plants, they cause stunning of the growth, browning, curling of the leaves. And there's a term that often people refer to as called hopper burn. What I can tell you, though, about this particular organism, it's really unfortunate, but some of the species can carry and transmit plant diseases. So they're vectors. We call them vectors of diseases. And many times the damage can be severe, particularly when the disease has been transmitted, the virus. And then it's really, really tough to do anything about, because we, in the world of pesticides, we have insecticides that control insects, miticides that control mites, fungicides that control fungi, bactericides that control bacteria, but we don't have viricides. So these plants, when they're infested, and then you get another group of leafhoppers on there, and they feed on the infested plant, and then they get the virus and they transmit it to the next. So this really becomes a perpetuation of the problem. Okay, tree hoppers. These guys have these very ornate, discernible characteristics in terms of, if you look just behind the head on the thorax or the wings. So look at these ornate type structures that they have. Well, as we talk about these, they have that big crest there. Relatively minor pests compared to these other species that we talked about. However, when we do see the damage, it's really superficial and cosmetic. And one thing that they can cause more damage by from feeding is when the females lay their eggs. So when a female lays eggs, there's an entomological term we use, it's called oviposition. When they lay their eggs, they create these oviposition scars, and it can actually be far more damaging to the plant than the actual feeding by the nymphs and the adults. Okay, how do we manage all of these sucking insects that I just talked about? Well, other than selecting varieties that aren't as susceptible, we have to resort to the use of insecticides. There's a wide variety of insecticides available. I will tell you this, particularly when we get to the scale insects, Dr. Cliff Sadoff, Purdue University, has a really nice website for sucking insects. So, in fact, I pirated this right from him, and he granted me permission. But this is just a really nice list, this table here, to show you what products can be used effectively to control this entire group of sucking insects that you see depicted over here to the left. So when Sharon affords you my presentation, you'll have this readily available. But in the interim, just write down Dr. Cliff Sadoff. So, I'm going to talk about these different types of insecticide, and they're really different classes of insecticide. We have the organophosphates, We have the carbamates, we have the synthetic pyrethroids, we have the neonicotinoids, and then there's some others. So let's go through this list. The organophosphates. These are pretty old chemistries that are afforded to us, but they still work pretty well. Now notice this product right here, chlorpyrifos, has an asterisk beside it. The reason is, no one in this room, anybody a nursery grower? Nope, I didn't think so. Anybody on a golf course? Oh! So you can still use this product on a golf course, chlorpyrifos. But if you're a homeowner or you're a lawn and landscape person, that product can no longer be used. So we're really limited to this particular active ingredient right here called acephate. That is the active ingredient. If you want to know a brand name with that, I'll give you one. It's called Orthene. O-R-T-H-E-N-E. The next class or group of chemistry are the carbamates. Once again, this is really old chemistry. The active ingredient, there's carbaryl. Many of you will know this name when I say it. Seven, S-E-V-I-N. That's a very good product. We also have the synthetic pyrethroids, and there are several of them. Many of those are available to homeowners, just like carbaryl is, just like acephate is. And then we have the neonicotinoids. Clothianidin, that one is not, well, it actually is available to a homeowner. It comes as a combination of clothianidin and imidacloprid. So, I don't endorse companies, but I'll give you an example of a company that has that combo product. That would be the Bayer Advanced line, but that just got sold to a company in France. And now it's called SBN. So you won't see the Bayer Advanced line any longer in the next 12 months. They're going to discontinue that and switch. Dinotefuran, that's a hard molecule to find for homeowners, and so is the thiamethoxam. But imidacloprid by itself, there's just an onslaught of companies that have that product available. Otherwise, some of the other chemistries that we have available to us are insecticidal soaps. Those are good. The only problem is, the limitation of those is, they are very sensitive to photodegradation. So when the sunlight gets on them, you have to reapply them in about 24 hours. We can also use horticultural oils. And then there's also some plant-based, i.e. we call those plant-derived materials, which would be botanically based. There's azadirachtin. Anybody familiar with azadirachtin? Comes from the neem tree. They take the seeds, they press the oils out of the seeds. It just so happens to have insecticidal properties. So all of these products that you see listed here will work quite well to control that guild, if you will, of insects listed over there to the left.
Chris?
Yes?
Neonicotinoids. Yeah.
Yep.
A lot of bad press with them with pollinators.
Yep.
What's your thoughts?
Well, how much time do you have? Okay, so here's what I will tell you. Social media, good or bad, likes to take pieces of information and run with that type of thing. I am up to my eyeballs involved in developing best management practices for using all insecticides appropriately, including neonicotinoids. So, here's what I'll say. Product stewardship is quintessential. People have to employ product stewardship. There are many instances where, and I think there's about 17 out of 20 some odd cases of neonicotinoid causing detriment to pollinators where it was an application error based on the applicator. If they would have just read the label like they were supposed to, which they chose not to, they either deliberately or unintentionally, I don't want to point fingers, didn't read the label. And they make applications inappropriately, and the label says right on there, do not apply to flowering trees or shrubs. Okay? So, do I think that neonicotinoids can have a detrimental effect on pollinators? Absolutely. Do I think if we use them judiciously and appropriately, will they have a adverse effect? Probably not. So let me give you an example. Honeybees. We're going to pick on them. My grandfather raised bees. In the United States, we use lots of neonicotinoids, not just for turf and ornamentals like we're talking about tonight, but veggie crops, fruit crops, field crops, corn, soybeans, you name it, they're using the neonicotinoids. So in the United States, we use large amounts of neonicotinoids. Okay, I'm going to take you to Australia. Let's jump over there for a minute. They use more neonicotinoids than we do. They have honeybees. We have honeybees. Their honeybees, the health, the overall health of their honeybees is exceptionally good. But yet they use lots of neonicotinoids. Our honeybee health is fairly poor. We use lots of neonicotinoids. So now, what other thing is at play? Well, there's a lot of other things at play. But one of the other big things is we have varroa mite. Varroa mite is a parasite of honeybees. It sucks the life out. It attaches on the back of a honeybee by its head and sucks the life out of it. So what do you think honeybee growers do to control that mite? They use miticides. And where do they use those miticides? In a confined space in their little hives, right? So we go to Australia, they don't have varroa mite. They use lots of neonicotinoids, their bees are doing fine. You come to the United States, we use lots of neonicotinoids. We have varroa mite, and our bees are doing poorly. So am I going to say it's just the varroa mite? No. Because you can go to France, they've banned the use of neonicotinoids for the last, I don't know how many years. And they still have huge problems with pollinator decline. So lots of confusion. So you opened up Pandora's box for a second, and I have a whole lecture on that for many hours to cover. But if I want to say it's solely neonicotinoids, I don't think so for a second. But do I think they could contribute if you use them inappropriately? Absolutely. But I'm going to back up one more step, and I'm going to end it here. Most pollinators, bumblebees, solitary bees, honeybees, are what? What are they? They're what? They're insects, right? What do insecticides control? So, I'm going to point a finger right now, directly, at this product. That's one of the worst products you could use around bees.
Which one?
Carbaryl. Seven. Seven is a no-no around bees because it's detrimental to them. So these people who have flowers and they're using seven dust all over them, what's happening to the pollinators? What's it doing to the pollinators? It's whacking them. So it's a complicated issue. And there's no, I can't give you a real definitive answer. So.
Well, I appreciate you saying something because I hadn't heard that in another talk, that it's all about the application. The label is the law, and if they're not following the label, then
they're breaking the law.
But that's what's in the media.
And they take that and run to the woods with it. Okay. They take it, yeah. And it really disheartens me because these tools that we have, they're tools. We need to use these tools wisely, not just nilly-willy. So anyway, I'm going to get off my soapbox now. You asked. I didn't bring it up. Okay, moving on, as they say. Let's see. Where was I when the lights went out in Georgia? So here we go. Management of sucking insects. And remember, I got a qualifier here. Please look at the top screen. Excluding scales. Okay, because we're going to get to scales in a minute. So, some of the aforementioned insecticide pests cause superficial or cosmetic damage. So therefore, don't use those products to go after them. Okay? Example, galls. I didn't talk about galls tonight. They're caused by psyllids. Just prune them out. Just like Eastern tent caterpillar. I'm not going to talk about it tonight. Just dig it out. Get it into your hands and rip it out. Throw it in the burn pile and watch them burn. Have some joy. We don't always have... And here's the thing. Insecticides are a tool. They shouldn't be our first line of defense. Sometimes they're our only line of defense. I get that. We're going to talk about emerald ash borer tonight. Guess what? Insecticides are our only line of defense there. I hate to say that, but they happen to be. And I'll explain why. Okay, scale insects. Any questions about the sucking insects that we just talked about? If not, I'm going to move into scales. Once again, Dr. Cliff Sadoff at Purdue has an incredibly good website. And I am a strong proponent. I hate it when people reinvent the wheel. If the wheel's already made and it's perfected, why should I try to reinvent it? Just because I feel like I need to beat my chest? No. I give Cliff all the credit on earth. So, he has a really good website. Here in the Midwest, about 60 species of scales. And we differentiate scales into two types. Armored, which are the hard scales, and soft scales. The way that scales feed, piercing, sucking mouth parts. They suck on plant juices. They're relatively immobile, and the only time that they move is when they're in the crawler stage. So, that's the most vulnerable life stage too, the crawler stage. And I'll explain this as we go. So, here is a very, very, very important piece of information I'm going to show you tonight. So, the most important thing I was going to tell you tonight was biological knowledge. You better know about it, right? Keep your friends close and your enemies closer. So, here is a snapshot at information regarding armored scales and soft scales. So, let's look at armored scales and contrast and compare them to soft scales. Armored scales, hard armored protective coating. Interestingly enough, even though that's a shell, like armored coating, we can remove it. Okay? Understand. So that's a very good thing to know. Soft scales, no true armor. They're protected by a waxy secretion that cannot be removed. Okay? So what's the difference? Armored, hard, can be removed. Soft, can't be removed. Okay. Another important thing. The length of the mouth parts. Who the heck cares how long their mouth parts are? They're causing damage. But you're going to see why this is very, very important in a minute. So, and I'm going to kind of divulge it here. Look at the feeding location. Let's look at armored scales. Where do they feed? Mesophyll. That's important to know. Where do soft scales feed? Phloem. Think about that. Just put that in the back of your mind for a minute. Soft scales feed in the phloem. Armored scales are mesophyll feeders. They'll also get into the xylem. Okay? What do we know about plant physiology? Everybody tell me. What moves the product up? What vascular system? Oh, come on. You guys are letting me down. A xylophone? Xylem. Xylem up, phloem down, right? Okay, good. I'm glad we got that clarified. Okay, another thing is, armored scales overwinter as eggs. Soft scales overwinter as nymphs. Now, look at the reproductive capacity, comparatively speaking. Females produce about 100 eggs. For the armored scales and for the soft scales, they produce about 1,000 eggs. So, that is, the last time I did math, and I failed math, that's about a tenfold increase, is it not? Very good. So, remember this, right here, feeding location. Mesophyll / xylem versus phloem. The other thing I forgot to mention, and it's very important, formation of honeydew. Armored scales do not produce or form honeydew. What does honeydew? Sugary type substance. Well, who, does anybody in here like, oh, I saw all the cookies out there. Sugary substances. What else, who else likes sugary substances? How about someone that's gonna protect these scales? Ants.
Ants.
So, armored scales, you think ants like armored scales, are they gonna protect those guys? Heck no. But what about soft scales? You betcha. Okay, so, cross-section of the leaf here. Here's the cuticle, here's the epidermis, here's the palisade mesophyll tissues. We get the armored scales feeding in there. They also, as I told you, get into the xylem, and then the soft scales, they only get into the phloem. So, who cares where they feed? Well, I'm going to explain that, why that's important in a little bit. So, armored scales. What do we know about armored scales? Do they produce honeydew?
No.
Nope. Where do they feed? In the mesophyll and in the xylem. And they have an armored protection, as you see depicted here. Okay? And you can pop it off if you walked up to it. They encrust branches and or leaves and cause dieback of the plant. So they can be very, very detrimental because they literally suck the life out of plants. And I already told you they form that shell-like cover. Okay? And when you flip the cover off, this is what you find. Nasty-looking things, aren't they? Okay? Here's a close-up. That's life-size right there. I'm kidding. So some of the armored scales that we have to contend with are obscure scale, oyster shell scale, pine needle scale, euonymus scale, and juniper scale. There are many, many other species, as I told you, but we don't have time to go through them all. I'm just going to go through a few of these. So obscure scale, we find this mainly on pin oaks, but occasionally we'll see them on some other species. Once again, we see that encrusting of the limbs and branches. It causes stress, dieback, tree decline, and in even some instances, we do see death occur. Here's some thinning or dieback from obscure scale. Now, if somebody sent me this and said, hey, Chris, what's going on? Well, they just stumped the chump here, because there could be a lot of things going on. First of all, what tree species is it? Because I don't know what that is from here. Oyster shell scale, another one, attacks lilac, maple, willow, ash, poplar, apple, hawthorn, dogwoods, and some others. Here's pine needle scale. Notice the crawlers up here. This is the most vulnerable of all life stages. This is a heavily... Oh, I went too fast. My mistake. We accept my apology here. Tried to hit this. You can see that's a heavily infested... So here's a mugo pine. There's pine needle scale. And that's the type of devastation that we can see as a result of this. Here's euonymus scale. Guess what plant species this attacks? Very good. Here's euonymus scale. Now, look, this is a terminology. I got to introduce this terminology. So in entomology, there's a lot of terms. How I remember them all, I've yet to figure that out. I guess that's the post-hole digger in me. Euonymus scales. We have what we call, in the entomology world, sexual dimorphism. That's fun to say, isn't it? So the males are white and the females are gray. So when you go in there, you can figure out the proportion of females. And if you know they lay eggs, well, guess what? We're in trouble. So, mainly, from a male perspective, they're the ones that mostly infest the leaves. And then remember this term that I introduced earlier, chlorosis due to feeding. So you see that yellowing. Here's some dieback on euonymus scale. That's an old picture, by the way. I got that from my PhD advisor. Okay, now, scales. How do we control them? Well, we use insecticides. But what happens if you use a product? So somebody asked you, what about the neonicotinoids? Before we go to Japanese field. What about the neonicotinoids? How do they work? Well, they're very unique because they work in three different ways. You can apply them topically, so they work by contact. You can apply them topically or foliarly, where they superficially translocate into the mesophyll tissues. We call that translaminar properties. But that product will not move, once it gets in the leaf, it will not move via the phloem downward. I don't know of any insecticide that moves in the phloem. The insecticides only move via the xylem. So, how could you get a product to move in the xylem? Apply it to the roots. So let's say you have a soft scale. And you apply a neonicotinoid to control soft scales as a soil drench. It's absorbed by the roots. It translocates via the xylem. Do you think you're going to get very good control of soft scales? Not a chance. Somehow my slides got out of whack, that's why we're kind of jumping around here. We'll get back. But, because we got to talk about soft skills. But the point is, if you use a neonicotinoid, and it's absorbed, and you've got a soft scale, like Magnolia scale, we're going to talk about that today. Magnolia scale is a nightmare. And I can't tell you how many commercial people go, Chris, I use this product. Da-da-da-da-da. And I said, well, why did you use that product? Well, it's a systemic. Yeah, but if the insect's not feeding on the xylem, what's going to happen? It's a full treatment. It's a waste of a treatment. Exactly. I don't know what happened to my slides here, folks. I sincerely apologize. So we'll jump Japanese beetle. We'll go back to the soft scale. Hopefully they'll reappear. So, Japanese beetle. Anybody familiar with this one? I have to say, tell you this story. This is funny. I've been here 19 years. And when I moved here, I started talking about Japanese beetle. People laughed at me. They literally laughed. Williamson, you're nuts. We don't have the problem with these guys. Guess what? I talked about emerald ash borer back in 2002. People said, what's the big deal? What's the big deal? I said, you just wait. So, I've been involved with this particular organism for a really long time, all the way through undergrad, grad, and PhD, and every since I've been here at the University of Wisconsin for 19 years. Prior to that, I was with a private company for 2 years as a research scientist before that. So, long, long time ago, as they say. So, Japanese beetle. Guess where this organism's from? Anybody want to take a guess? Japan, right. So, here's an example of an exotic, invasive organism that's very problematic. And what's really problematic about this guy, we get a double whammy. It feeds on turf as a grub, and it feeds on ornamentals as a grub. I'm not going to tell you that it won't, because it'll feed on herbaceous ornamentals, woody ornamentals. But as an adult, it feeds on over 350 species of plant material. And when it feeds, it has chewing mouth parts, it causes a lot of damage. Now, I will say, it is a pretty good looking beetle. You have to admit. You have to admit it is. Okay? So let's talk about the biology of this guy. Well, the adults typically emerge here in Wisconsin in mid-June with peak adult emergence around the early July. Now, this all of these organisms we're talking about today are biological. So there is variability. So I've seen them not emerge until early September. That's uncommon, but it can happen. The adults are very gregarious, sun-loving animals. What do I mean by gregarious? They hang out together and they're active together and they like the sun. So what time of day do you think they're active? 1 a.m. or 1 p.m? 1 p.m. And honestly, from about 9 a.m. till 5-ish, and so they must have an 8-hour work day, I'm not sure. But they are very sun-loving animals. And when they feed, they're not defoliators, they're skeletonizers. They feed within the margins of the veins. The adults, they feed on leaves, flowers, and fruit. So you get the trifecta here. Not only do they feed on leaves, they feed on flowers. Anybody have roses? Have you ever seen them feed on roses? Yes, you have. They'll also feed on fruit. And as I told you, they attack about 350 species. One thing that we know about this organism, 1 year life cycle. Very important that we know that. Here are the life stages. So this is an example. All the rest that we talked about thus far, other than this one, are examples of insects that have incomplete life cycle. These guys have complete. So we have over here on the far right, we have an adult, we have both males and females. How do they talk to each other? How do they communicate? Pheromones. Pheromones, very good. So a female emits a chemical sex attractant. How do insects smell? What kind of noses? I haven't really noticed the nose on them. How do they smell? Their bodies, but how? What organ on their bodies do they smell? What structure? Feet? That'd be good if they were a fly. Antennae, very good. Somebody said it. So males have what we call plumose-like antennae. They're feather-ish-like. And they have chemoreceptors on there. So they sniff through their antennae, pick up that chemical attractant. And when you see a ball of Japanese beetles, usually there's one female and the remainder are males because they're all trying to copulate with her. So once she is mates and becomes fertilized, she lays eggs. Here's what an egg looks like. Then those eggs hatch. You get a first instar grub. They molt and grow and develop through that process called molting. Go to the second, ultimately to the third. And then there is a life stage that we didn't see with those other organisms, because the other organisms have adults, eggs, and nymphs. That's it. These guys have to go through a transformation stage. We call the pupal stage. So this is a life stages. So we have how many here? 1, 2, 3, and 4. 4 life stages for insects that have complete metamorphosis. Only 3 life stages for insects that have incomplete. Does that make sense? That's clear as mud, right? Okay. Here is the actual life cycle of a Japanese beetle. And I have to commend my really good friend and colleague, Dr. Fred Baxendale at Nebraska, for this slide. This is the life cycle that I talked about. So they start to emerge sometime in June, peak adult emergence around the 1st of July, lay their eggs, and they don't just lay their eggs in turf, folks. They'll lay their eggs in mulch beds and the like. So because I told you, the larvae don't just feed on turf grass, they feed on woody and herbaceous ornamental plant material. Now, I will tell you, if you're going after the grubs, here's the best time to clobber them, right here. Because as they get bigger, they're harder to control. And I'm not going to go into that today. And to that end, when they're big, they're hard to control. They're even harder to control in the spring. So if you're going to go after grubs, you go after them there. We'll talk about adults. So I told you they're very sun-loving, gregarious animals. This is a classic example. This is taken in you might as well call it Madison. It's called Monona. It's a little burg in Madison. If anybody been to Monona, you know. This is Monona Golf Course. This is some white birch, and if we're looking at this tree, notice over here it looks a little bit green because they're very sun-loving, gregarious animals. As they skeletonize that tree all the way down, they'll get over to here, but this is the southern exposure right here, and that's why. Guess what side this is? North. So no great surprise there. I told you that they're skeletonizers. This really depicts that right here. This really illustrates the fact that they are skeletonizers. And I told you, you get the trifecta. They like leaves, they like flowers, and they like fruit. So these guys have no mercy. And by the way, just so you know, this is a male, there's a female, that's a male, that's a female. They mate, and by the way, I'll get into this in a moment. All right, I'll just tell you here. They live, an adult will live for about 45-60 days, so that would be a month and a half or two once they emerge. And during her lifetime, she mates multiple times, and each time she lays eggs, she can probably lay up to about 60 to 90 eggs in her lifetime. So think of how many beetles that you see out there, and usually it's a one-to-one sex ratio, one male, one part male, one-to-one ratio of male to females. I can speak English most days, just not today. Okay, so what can we do to manage these guys? Well, we can use systemic insecticides as a soil drench or an injection. We can use the translaminar products that are applied to the foliage during adult activity after flowering, because let's say you have a linden tree. Lindens are pollinated by bees. So would it be advantageous to apply an insecticide that kills insects to a flowering plant? Absolutely not. So if you have a plant that's flowering, we want to do it, make our application after. Here's the dilemma though, or the quandary. What happens if that plant happens to flower that coincides with when the beetles are there? That's a tough one, isn't it? And I don't have an answer for you. We can use contact insecticides applied directly to actively feeding adults. We want to do this in sunny conditions in the upper canopy and after flowering. Once again, we want to avoid those applications. One thing I want to point out, imidacloprid, that's a neonicotinoid. It's a systemic insecticide. It's absorbed by the roots. It's translocated via the xylem, and it sinks in the leaves. Then when a Japanese beetle feeds on it, it gets a lethal concentration. But no longer can we use imidacloprid to control Japanese beetle on basswood or lindens, because they found that imidacloprid can get into the pollen and nectar. So this is no longer can we do this. So what do we do? Okay, I'm going to challenge you on that. I got a 45-foot linden tree at home.
Your husband up there.
I don't advocate that. Now, there is another product called, and I mentioned it earlier, it's acephate. Okay? There's a brand name, and I don't normally talk brand names, but I'm going to give you a brand name. It's called Lepitec. And it's manufactured by the Rainbow Tree Care Scientific out of Minneapolis area. That Lepitec is labeled as a soil drench to control Japanese beetles. So we do have an alternative to the neonicotinoids for treating lindens.
Can you spell that?
Right here. Next slide. So treatments that we have, I will tell you this too. I'll explain these to you and I'll get back to your question, sir. So here's acetamidiprid. The brand name on that is called TriStar. What's interesting about that, that's a neonicotinoid, but it's a bee-friendly neonicotinoid. Of all the neonicotinoids, this is the only one that's bee-friendly. So this is an option, but you can't use it as a soil drench because it's not on the label. You can do it as a foliar, so you could use it as a translaminar, or you could use it as a foliar when the beetles are there. But remember, all of these are applied after flowering. Here's clothianidin that can be applied as a foliar, not as a drench. Here's dinotefuran. It's labeled for a drench, but I'll tell you right now, it won't control Japanese beetles. It's horrible. Here's imidacloprid. Notice the asterisk. The asterisk just means cannot be applied as a soil drench. Here's thiamethoxam. This is even available to homeowners. And here's the acephate. So here's the Lepitec. That's the Orthene. That's by Rainbow Tree Care Scientific out of Minneapolis. So if you're interested in doing a soil drench to control a linden. Now, it's a misfortune that imidacloprid is detrimental to bees in that particular species, because it just so happens that in lindens, the physiology of that plant tree is such that that material can get into the pollen. But that doesn't mean it gets into the pollen of other species, because not all species are created the same. So, my point is, let's go back to that example, the 45-foot linden tree. It's a heck of a lot easier for me as an applicator, and also mitigate the risk of exposure to other people and the environment, for me to do a soil drench of this material, acephate, to that 45-foot linden tree, because I only have to drench around the basal area. It's absorbed by the roots, translocates via the xylem, sinks in the leaves, all is well. Versus going out there with a hose sprayer trying to spray a 40-foot tree. Come on. Not good. Translaminar products, these are the same products that I just talked about that have the translaminar properties. So systemic products, they're the same. So it's virtually the same slide. And then contact insecticides. If you're going to treat with a contact, there are these products available. But remember, do not apply products when the plant's flowering. The only exception to that is this product right here. Chlorantraniliprole. Say that four times. No. Chlorantraniliprole is, the brand name is called Acelaprin. I don't think it's quite yet available to homeowners, but with the internet, you can buy anything you want. And this product here is an extraordinarily bee-friendly material. But notice I didn't have it listed as a systemic. I've evaluated this product as a systemic. It just does not work very well. But as a foliar, as a contact spray, it works really quite well. The other product is permethrin. This is a botanically based product. Guess what plant this is derived from? Chrysanthemum.
Okay? That's right.
Okay, any questions about Japanese beetle? I'll try to answer.
How long does it take the systemic to actually work?
Very good question. Tree size has a lot to do with it. Tree species has a lot to do with it. So, if you have a tree, let's just take since we can't treat lindens anymore. Let's say we were going to treat a white birch. Because Japanese beetles do love white birch. I showed a good picture of that. Let's say you were going to treat a white birch. It's going to be product dependent. So if you used imidacloprid to treat a white birch, and it's a, let's say it's a 50-foot birch tree, I would say as soon as the frost is out of the ground, you're going to want to get that tree treated well before it leaves out, well before, because it's going to take that long for that absorption and translocation to occur. Now, compare and contrast that to, say, you were going to use the Lepitec. That is much more water soluble. It can be taken up much more rapidly. I would say about a month before the adults emerge. So if we anticipate adults June 20th, I'd say May 20th. You'd be just fine. Make sense? Any other questions on Japanese beetle? Everybody's got a good handle on that? Okay, now we're going to jump right into some boring insects. We got the two-line chestnut borer, a very important pest. And I'm going to show you some commonalities and yet some differences. So, two-line chestnut borer, it's a native species. Remember that, native species. So it's native to North America. It's in the order of insects called Coleoptera, which are the beetles. It's in the family called Buprestidae, which are the metallic wood-boring beetles. So the adults, we call them metallic wood borers. The larvae, we call flat-headed borers. The host for the two-line chestnut borer include oak, chestnut. But what's really interesting about this species and the next species that I'm going to talk about, they mainly largely attack stressed trees. Okay? So there's a big thing that you need to remember. Two-line chestnut borer, and the next one we're going to talk about is bronze birch borer, they predominantly attack stressed trees. The life cycle of this, typically 1 year. In some instances, it can take 2 years in northern climates and on really poor trees that aren't very healthy. But by and large, one generation per year. This is what the two-line chestnut borer looks like. Anybody want to guess why they call it the two-line chestnut borer? Now, remember head, thorax, abdomen. And we're looking at this insect from the top, right? We're looking down on it. So we're looking at the dorsal side, right? Everybody agree with that? The belly of the beast, so I've got this pointer and you're in the back, you can't see it, but this pointer really is representative of that beetle. So if I hold it like on the underside of this pointer, it's rounded. So the ventral side of this organism is rounded. The dorsal side, i.e. the top side, is flat. So when this guy chews its way out of its host, what kind of exit hole do you think it creates?
A
D-shape. What other species creates a D-shape? We'll get to that in a bit. Okay, in terms of the feeding, they feed under the bark, the larvae do, and they create these galleries where they destroy the conductive tissues of the plant. You're going to be mindful of the time here. They destroy the conductive tissues of the plant. And when they do that, that's just like me sneaking to your house right now. If I were to run out here and knew where you lived, and just cut up all your water lines in your house. How's your plumbing going to work? Not so well. So that's really what they're doing. They're destroying the plumbing of the plant. And when they do that, no longer can materials, i.e. water and nutrients, be absorbed and translocated up. And then what does this sun thing do? What's that called? Photosynthesis. Creates sugars and energy. So if we've got xylem going up with water and nutrients, and phloem going down, bringing the sugars back down, and we disrupt that plumbing, what happens to that plant?
It dies.
And oftentimes with these boring insects, we will see the initial symptoms as upper crown canopy dieback. Very characteristic. Okay. Initial injury symptoms here cause girdling, first appears as limb dieback and thinning of the crown. So the upper canopy of the tree we call the crown. Bronze birch borer does the same thing. And we already talked about these D-shaped exit holes. And from a biological perspective, the adults emerge in June through mid-September. They're very gregarious, sun-loving animals. When they lay their eggs, they lay them in the cracks and crevices of the trunk bark, usually in sections exposed to sunlight. Well, no great surprise there. And then the larvae, once those eggs hatch, they feed in the cambial area, destroying those conductive tissues. What can we do to manage these guys? Well, you're going to see some reoccurring common themes here. But for two-line chestnut borer and for bronze birch borer, which we'll get to in a moment, we can use systemic insecticides. The preceding fall, which we find is a better way to do this for these guys, as a preventative treatment, not as a curative. So we can use things like imidacloprid, clothianidin, thiamethoxam. I know that triage is available for emerald ash borer, but not a real big proponent of drilling into trees, folks. And the only way you can treat ash trees to control emerald ash borer is to drill into the tree with the triage, that is. It has to be trunk ejected. Otherwise, we've got these products available that work just fine. We can also use bark spray applications to control them. We can use things like permethrin, bifenthrin, and then for nurseries, we can use chlorpyrifos, but that product's only registered for nursery and golf course use. Okay, bronze birch borer, another native species, same order, same family. Get this, same genus. I'm gonna back up a second if it'll let me. So two-line chestnut borer, that's Agrylis bilinatus. See how that rears up, bilateral? So bilinatus. So here's Agrylis anxious. So bronze birch borer is Agrylis anxious. Wait till we get to emerald ash borer. That's Agrylis planipennis. So they're all in the same order, they're all in the same family, and they're all in the same genus. So, I won't belabor the point with the metallic wood borers and the flat-headed borer. This time, the host are European white birch, especially stress trees. We do not see bronze birch borer in river birch. They just don't, they're not a host. 1 year life cycle. Here is an example of a bronze birch borer adult. Once again, bullet-shaped, and they, just like the two-line chestnut borer, flat on top, round on the bottom. So when they chew their way out, they create a D-shaped exit hole. In terms of their feeding galleries, and I didn't mention this with the two-line chestnut borer, but I want to make note of this, for the two-line chestnut borer, and for the bronze birch borer, and for the emerald ash borer, when they feed, they pack their feeding galleries with frass. So, classic example, if you walked up to a birch, and you found sawdust all over the ground, it's probably not bronze birch borer. If you walked up to an oak or a chestnut and you found sawdust all over the ground, it's probably not two-line chestnut borer. Because these guys, these larvae, they pack their feeding galleries with frass. Initial damage, symptoms appear as crown dieback. We've heard that before. The larvae mainly feed in the cambial area, and they cause girdling that spirals around the tree. So a little bit different types of damage here compared to what we talked about with the two-line chestnut borer. But here's a commonality, D-shaped exit hole. So when we see that upper crown canopy dieback, this is a heavily infested tree, and you can see that callousing, that spiraling type of larval feeding that's taking place out of sight, out of mind, underneath the bark in the cambial area. If you were to take a knife out, or like a utility knife, or a hand tool, carve that back, you could easily find the larvae in there, depending upon the time of year. Okay? The adults here, they emerge in May, late May through June, and they lay their eggs mainly in the upper crown on branches that are less than an inch in diameter. Once again, stress trees are more susceptible. And as we've already talked about, the larvae, they feed in that cambial area. Same exact methodology to manage these guys is what we talked about with two-line chestnut borer. I'm looking at the clock, and it's 10 till. So I think I got enough time to get through emerald ash borer, and we're going to take a break. And then I'm going to figure out what on creation happened to my soft scales. I'm befoobled. If not, I've got a presentation on there. I'll pull it up. Not a big deal. Not a big deal. Okay, emerald ash borer. This beauty. What did I tell you about bronze birch borer and two-line chestnut borer? I told you they're beetles. They're in the family Buprestidae. They're in the genus Agrylis. But what else did I tell you? They're both native. This one, guess what? Not native. So he's probably a distant relative that's not welcomed. It's like a dead fish. After 3 days, it starts to smell. Tell them to go back home, right? So, but metallic wood boring beetle. larvae. There's four, I don't have all four life stages here. Those other species that I just showed you, the two-line chestnut borer and the bronze birch borer, they too have four larval stages. What are Japanese beetle? How many larval stages did they have? Three. These guys have four. I don't have the fourth up here, but nonetheless, there's four larval stages, and guess what? They're all feeding machines. They feed 24/7, 365. And when they feed, they destroy the conductive tissues. And when they feed, they pack their feeding galleries with frass. Okay? And when they feed, they destroy the conductive tissues, and consequently, they destroy the plants. So, let's talk a little bit about the history of this organism. So, yes, it's an exotic, invasive species. It's native to Asia. First discovered here in the U.S., actually about where I grew up, Detroit's about 45 miles from where I grew up. I'm from Ohio, northwest, near Toledo, Ohio, and Detroit's not too awful far away. They found it in June of 2002. And when they did the dendrological Sherlock Holmes studies, they figured out that this thing had been there probably about a decade prior.
Wow.
That's the sad part. And it's been theorized and pretty well documented that it arrived here on solid wood packing material 10 years previously. And when they found it in an industrial park area in Detroit metro area. And guess what was in that industrial park area? Guess what they were bringing in from China?
Pallets
of auto parts. So, one, I won't name who, but one of the big manufacturers over there was, and they didn't know, I mean, it's not like they deliberately brought them in, but I will tell you that the Chinese have taken a proactive step in this. No longer do they go out and just nilly-willy fell trees, particularly ash trees, and make pallets out of them. Now they're using plastic pallets. So that will help to mitigate the spread and introduction of other pests. But as they say, this genie's out of the bottle. So here in Wisconsin, it was first discovered in August of 2008 near Newburgh, Wisconsin. And it's been theorized that that infestation probably had been there since early 2000. So it takes a while for that to manifest itself. In terms of how this organism is largely spread here in the U.S. is through firewood, particularly. So, you see this guy? Have camper, will travel. I'm with stupid. And we laugh about this, but this is really how it does readily get moved about. Is it the only way? Not at all. But is it the predominant way? Yes. And when these guys feed, they feed under the bark, and these guys create a very discernible feeding behavior. It's this S-shaped serpentine feeding galleries that they create. In terms of spread, this is from February of 2017. This is everywhere the EAB is.
I'll give you guys a little, show you where I grew up. So here's the Detroit area. Here's where I grew up. It's widespread through Ohio. It's amazing when I go back home. As I've gone back home in the last few years, I can just tell where EAB is because the trees are just, they're hammered. But what's interesting is, right here's where I grew up, right there in that northwest quadrant. I grew up in a little town called Defiance, Ohio, about 20,000 people. And in the county that I'm in, county fairs are big here, and they're big back home. I'd go to the county fair, show hogs every year. Grew up on a farm. In the town where the county fair is called Hicksville, Ohio. Everything's Ville over there. I don't know. There's just a lot of Villes. But I grew up in Defiance, so I didn't grow up in Ville. But to that end, in Hicksville, there's a tool handle factory. What do they make tool handles out of? Ash. They make them out of hickory too, but mainly ash. Guess where that tool handle factory was getting their wood from? Michigan. How do you think it got to Defiance County? Okay, but nonetheless, you can see the distribution of EAB. So anywhere you see a red dot, it's been confirmed. So boom, Colorado. Well, Kansas doesn't have a lot of trees. Nebraska, it's in the Omaha area. Iowa, I'll tell you what, Minnesota, That's the scary one. Lot of species of ash up there. Not that we don't have a lot, because we do as well. But you can kind of see it's really moved
widespread, especially since. So, once again, EAB biology, it's a buprestid metallic wood borer. It's in the Gryllus species, very closely related to bronze birch borer and two-line chestnut borer. Guess what? Very gregarious, sun-loving animal. It really likes trees in open settings. They're most vulnerable to attack. Adults are pretty good flyers compared to other beetle species. So Japanese beetle's a pretty good flyer, but these guys are even better. They can fly about 7 miles. Okay? In terms of what species they attack, predominantly ash. And when I say ash, I'm talking about Fraxinus species. But what's different about EAB, other than we know it's exotic, compared to the other two species, it attacks stress or healthy trees. And the other thing is tree size has no influence. So it can be a half inch DBH. Everybody know how to measure DBH? Okay, I'll tell you how you do it. Simple. Walk up to a tree, 4.5 feet off the ground. You measure the circumference. And once again, I failed math. I'm kidding. But remember pi? Pi? We just had Pi Day the other day.
Yeah.
3.14.
So you take the circumference, divide by pi. That tells you DBH. So I'm going to use easy math because I told you I'm not good. I got a 31.4-inch circumference tree. So do the math for me. Somebody help me. How many inch DBH tree do I have?
10.
Very good. So doesn't matter if you have a half-inch DBH tree or you have a 60-inch DBH tree. So what's 60 times 3.14? I don't know. I can't do the math. I told you that. So size, they don't, well, that was not good. Okay. That was not good. Okay.
So let's talk about life cycle. I told you, biology. That's very important. Just like when you buy your house. Don't you think it's funny when something, if I offend somebody, I'm apologizing to you right now. I gotta ask this. Does anybody live near the airport? Do you live at the end of the runway? Does anybody live near the train tracks?
Yep.
You knew that when you bought your house, though, did you not?
Absolutely.
Okay, good. Because I got a friend that moved to California, and out there he has a Cracker Jack box for $400,000. I mean, 1,100 square feet. $400,000, and he buys it right by the track, and I thought the train was coming through the house. You get used to it. But what about the people that buy a house near the end of the runway and they complain about the planes coming over? Okay, so biology. So let's look at the biology. Keep in mind this is a biological organism, so there's variability. So the adults start to emerge in late May. Peak adult emergence is in June. But notice I say August. Well, how is that? Variability. So the adults lay eggs. The eggs hatch, and we get larvae. The larvae are legless. Do all insects have legs?
No.
So these guys don't have legs. Neither did the two-line chestnut borer, neither did the bronze birch borer. But the eggs hatch, you get larvae. The larvae immediately chew, because they have chewing mouthparts, right through the bark, and they get in the cambial area, and they feed. They feed June, July, August, September, October, and a little bit into November. And then they begin the transformation process, where they transform from the larva into the adult, and then they do this November through the latter part of May, and then they emerge as an adult. So by and large, they have one generation per year. Okay? Once again, contrast comparison. Here are two other very closely related species we've already discussed. I told you they like open areas. So this is in Madison, actually. They just hammered these trees here. This is up in Newburgh. And this is a typical edge effect. So, yeah, there's other ash trees inside the canopy of that woodlot or forested area. But notice where they attack first, out on the edge. Why? Sun-loving gregarious. I told you tree size doesn't matter. Look at these little things. They're done. You got to get them out of there. There's no turning back. Get the chainsaw out or dig them out with a skid steer or something. Here, you either get the steel or the Husqvarna out. That's over. Party's over. That's heavily infested. The adults are emerald green. They're actually a really beautiful beetle, but
I don't like what they do. D-shaped body, 3/8 of an inch to 1/2 inch in length. And when they chew their way out, as you see depicted, D-shaped. The larvae are legless, I've already told you that. Fully developed larvae is about 1.5 inches in length. They have a 10-segmented body with cream-colored, distinct bell-shaped abdominal segments. Not all of them are real discernible, but these latter ones are. Doesn't that look like a bell? Everybody agree? Yeah. They don't all look definitively like a bell, but there are a few that do. Okay, damage. We've already talked about damage with bronze birch borer and two-line chestnut borer, but these guys do the same thing. They feed in the xylem and the phloem. They destroy the conductive tissues. And then the damage typically originates in the upper canopy, as you see here. And then as that tree exhibits signs and symptoms, you'll just get that crown canopy dieback. And this is what it looks like when they get further down into the tree. So the upper part of the tree is called the crown. The lower part is called the bole, B-O-L-E. Have you heard that term before? That's called the bole, down in the trunk. Now, what is this a picture of? What on earth is, what do I got a picture of here? Achilles heel. So what's the Achilles heel of this organism? Anybody? Early detection. We don't have a tool. You've seen these blasted purple traps that get out there. What's funny about that? They had 6 of those purple traps within 1/16 of a mile in Newburgh and never found a single adult. But yet the trees were dead. How'd those traps work for you? Not so well. So the Achilles heel of this organism is that there is no effective or efficient early detection tool or strategy. Man, I wish I could come up with one. I wish I would have come up with, because I could be retired right now. Damage symptom often occurs, the canopy dieback, after measurable damage results, and infestation levels high. So I'll put this into layman's term. You're a day late, and you're a dollar. Sure. Thank you. You guys are great. Okay, so look at the succession here. So these were all infested at the same time, but look in the back. This guy, lights out. Look at this guy. Now, in theory, this tree is still, if you will, treatable or salvageable. We could still save the life of that, but look up above. Would it be advantageous to think about treating that tree? A, it's on a hillside, a lot of stress. B, what's right above it? Power lines. Makes no sense to treat that tree, does it? I'd just hack them all down and start over. Okay, the host. Ash trees, Fraxinus, green ash, white ash, blue ash, black ash, European ash, pumpkin ash, velvet ash, there's lots of them. Once again, mountain ash, not a problem. Why? It's in the Sorbus species. Okay, I'm over. I'm going to take a break. We'll come back and we'll ask the question, are insecticides effective? Because there are some misnomers out there. Then I'm going to try to figure out what on earth happened to... Oh, here, Sharon told me this. This is an indication. It's breaking. Oh, yeah, Otavil, see?